Divisions of Hell, Chapter 17 of the Bhagavad Gita, Text 1. Arjuna Uvacha.
Uvacha.
Ye Shastra Vidim Ustrijya.
Ye Shastra Vidim Ustrijya.
Yajante Shraddhayan Vitaha.
यजन्ते श्रद्धयान्विताः
तेषां निष्ठतु का कृष्णं
तेषां निष्ठतु का कृष्णा
सत्वं आहो रजस्तमा
सत्वं आहो रजस्तमा.
Arjuna inquired, O Krishna, what is the situation of those who do not follow the principles of scripture but worship according to their own imagination? Are they in goodness, passion, or in ignorance? So this is a natural question, because Krishna gave so much information about following scriptures, you know, seeking shelter of a guru, going through step-by-step process. And then Arjuna is asking a counter question. What if I worship according to my own imagination? May I create my own God and I start worshiping that? Will it make any sense? So let's see what Krishna will say. And Naga Prabhu, go ahead with the purport.
In the fourth chapter, 39th verse, it is said that a person faithful to a particular type of worship gradually becomes elevated to the stage of knowledge and attains the highest perfectional stage of peace and prosperity. In the 16th chapter, it is concluded that one who does not follow the principles laid down in the scriptures is called as asura, demon. And one who follows the scripture injunctions faithfully is called a deva or demigod. Now, if one with faith follows some rules which are not mentioned in the scriptural injunctions, what is his position? This doubt of Arjuna's is to be cleared by Krishna. Are those who create some sort of God by selecting a human being and placing their faith in him, worshipping in goodness, passion, or ignorance? Do such persons attain the perfectional stage of life? Is it possible for them to be situated in real knowledge and elevate themselves to the highest perfectional stage? Do those who do not follow the rules and the regulations of the scriptures, but who have faith in some and men attain success in their effort? Arjuna is putting these questions to Krishna.
Yeah, so I think it's relatively straightforward. He is now asking about people who do their own thing, manufacture their own religion. Let's see what the Lord says now. श्री भगवान उवाच त्रिविधा भवति श्रद्धा
भगवान उवाच
त्रिविधा भवति श्रद्धा
त्रिविधा भवति श्रद्धा
देहिनां सा स्वभावजम्
देवीनां सा स्वभावज
सात्विकी राजसी चैवम्
सात्विकी राजसी चैव
तामसी चेति तं शृणु
तामसी चेति तं शृणु.
The Supreme Personality of God, it said, according to modes of nature acquired by embodied soul, one's faith can be of three kinds: in goodness, in passion or in ignorance. Now hear about this. So now Krishna is giving scientific division, vibhajan of the nature acquired by the soul. Okay, go ahead, please read the purport.
Those who know the rules and regulations of the scriptures, but out of laziness or indolence given up following the rules and regulations, are governed by the modes of material nature according to their previous activities in the mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. They acquire a nature which is of a specific quality. The association of Nili, since the living entity is in contact with material nature, he acquires different type of mentality according to his association with the material modes. But this nature can be changed if one associates with the bona fide spiritual master and abides by his rule and the spirit and the scriptures. Gradually, one can change his position from ignorance to goodness or from passion to goodness. The conclusion of that blind faith in a particular mode of nature cannot help a person become elevated to the perfectional stage. One has to consider things carefully with intelligence in the association of a bona fide spiritual master. Thus, one can change his position to a higher mode of nature.
Yeah. So basically, here we are talking about change the position from ignorance to goodness or from passion to goodness, which means changing of one's modes is possible. So right now, we may be in a mode that is potentially ignorance. That's okay. But when we take up to this process of Krishna consciousness, then we can actually change our mode from ignorance to passion or from ignorance to goodness, from passion to goodness, etc. The conclusion is that blind faith in a particular mode of nature cannot help a person become elevated to the perfectional stage. So blind faith will not help a person. One has to consider things carefully with intelligence. These are the keywords, right? Unless we show proper care and display our intelligence, and that too in the association of a bona fide spiritual master. Because what the bona fide spiritual master will do, he'll say, no, this is not the good direction. Although it is good from a regular perspective, it may not be good for you, right? So for example, if you have to drive 40, 50 miles every day to work, and that tires you out, and then you don't have time for chanting your rounds or doing some spiritual activity, then the spiritual master may say, okay, why don't you find a job closer? I know you may be getting a little less salary, but why don't you do that? Or if somebody is working in a slaughterhouse, killing animals, and Bhagavad Gita, once the person reads, he says, oh, this is Jiva Himsa, we should not kill animals. Okay, maybe he'll get some other job, little less salary, that's okay. But he will move in that direction, like that. So that's why association of a bona fide spiritual master in the parampara to take day-to-day advice, right? I mean, I take advice frequently from my spiritual master on what's to be done and what's not to be done. So sometimes I will think that he will ask me not to do it. Then I go and ask him and he says, no, you continue doing it because in this current stage of your life, this is actually okay. But maybe 10 years down the road, you should not be doing that because at that time you should become more serious like that. So sometimes we may imagine stuff. Oh, maybe this is not good, or maybe this is good. And when you go and talk to the spiritual master, you'll get exactly opposite. You may get exactly opposite conclusion. Right? So that's always needed to take advice from spiritual authorities. So let's move on. Sattvanupa sarvasya.
Sattvanupa sarvasya.
Shraddha bhavati bharata.
Shraddha bhavati bharata.
Shraddhamayo ayam purusho.
Shraddhamayo ayam purusho.
Yoyak shraddha sa eva saha.
Yoyak shraddha.
O son of Bharata, according to one's existence under the various modes of nature, one evolves a particular kind of faith. The living being is said to be of a particular faith according to the modes he has acquired. So a soul in a body may be in mode of goodness. So it will get attracted to a faith or devotional activity in the mode of goodness. So which is like, you know, going regularly to temple, taking bath regularly, listening to pleasing music. And somebody in the mode of ignorance will also do some kind of devotion, but that will be very different. So that fellow may pray to Lord, not Lord, but Goddess Kali. He would like to sacrifice animals in front of Goddess Kali, right? And he's also thinking, yeah, I'm such a great devotee. Look at me. I worked so hard, went into the forest, I bought these animals. Now I am sacrificing in front of Mother Kali. Like that. Of course, Mother Kali will not take his sacrifice. She will appreciate the intention in the heart and she'll give the fellow some benefit, but she will not take the sacrificed animal. She'll give it to some ghosts or goblins around her, because Mother Kali has a lot of these assistants. Many of them are ghosts, rakshasas, like that. So she'll give all that blood offered in the sacrifice to the ghosts and the rakshasas around her, like that. So there is faith. There is faith in ignorance. There is faith in passion. There is faith in goodness. So people, example, you may, you know, pray to God for money. You may say, God, give me money. I want, you know, I bought this stock at 100. Give me, make it go to 120. So let me get rich. That's also faith, because you are praying, but you are praying for the wrong reason. That's why it is in the mode of passion, because when you are in passion, usually you cannot control yourself. You'll move forward with making some decisions. Okay, Shiva, can you read the purport?
Everyone has a particular type of faith, regardless of what he is. But his faith is considered good, passionate, or ignorant according to the nature he has acquired. Thus, according to his particular type of faith, one associates with certain persons. Now, the real fact is that every living being, as is stated in the 15th chapter, is originally a fragmental part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, one is originally transcendental to all the modes of material nature. But when one forgets this relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead and comes into contact with the material nature in conditional life, then he generates his own position by associating with the different varieties of material nature. The resultant artificial faith and existence are only material. Although one may be conducted by some impression or some conception of life, originally he is nirguna or transcendent. Therefore, one has to become cleansed of the material contamination that he has acquired in order to gain his relationship with the Supreme Lord. And it is the only path back without fear. Krishna consciousness. If one is situated in Krishna consciousness, then that path is guaranteed far is elevation to the perfectional stage. If one does not take to this path of self-realization, then he is surely to be conducted to the influence of the modes of nature.
Yeah. So if one does not take to this path of self-realization, which is what Bhagavad Gita is all about, then he is conducted by the modes of nature. Right? So what happens? Modes of material nature are like three policemen. If you are in the influence of passion, then that policeman will start guiding you. Okay, do this, do this, do this. If you are predominantly in mode of ignorance, then that person will be saying, okay, take it easy, be lazy, what do you have to achieve? So the person becomes very dull. And if somebody is conducted by goodness, then the person says, okay, I will just be calm and contented, but won't do anything else. So we have to get out of even goodness. Goodness is not good enough. So we have to come out of goodness and go even higher like that. Okay, continue.
The word sraddha or faith is very significant in this verse. Sraddha or faith originally comes out of the mode of goodness. One's faith may be a demigod or some created god or some mental concoction. One's strong faith is supposed to be productive of works of material goodness. But in material conditional life, no works are completely pure. They are mixed. They are not in pure goodness. Pure goodness is transcendental. In purified goodness, one can understand the real nature of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. As long as one's faith is not completely in purified goodness, the faith is subjected to contamination by any of the modes of material nature. The contaminated modes of material nature expand in the heart. Therefore, according to the position of the heart in contact with a particular mode of material nature, one's faith is established. It should be understood that if one's heart is in the mode of goodness, faith is also in the mode of goodness. If his heart is in the mode of passion, faith is also in the mode of passion. And if his heart is in the mode of darkness, illusion, his faith is also thus contaminated. Thus, we find different types of faith in this world. There are different types of religions due to different types of faith. The real principle of faith is situated in the mode of pure goodness, but because the heart is tainted, we find different types of religious principles. Thus, according to different types of faith, there are different types of worship, kinds of worship.
Very good. So what is your name?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yes. What is your name?
Warren.
Very nice. Yeah, thank you. You read so nicely. Which grade are you in?
I'm in fourth grade.
Fourth grade, yeah. Very smart. In fourth grade, I could not read like you. Okay, that's it.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna. Let's move on. So, text 4, Lord continues, Yajante Satvika Devan.
Yajante Satvika Devan.
Yaksha Rakshamsi Rajasaha.
Yaksha Rakshamsi Rajasaha.
Pretan Bhuta Ganam Shanye.
Pretan Bhuta Ganam Shanye.
Yajante tamasa janaha.
Yajante tamasa
janaha. Yeah, so he's giving the description of Rakshasas and how they behave and so on, right? Men in the mode of goodness worship the demigods, devatas. Those in the mode of passion worship the demons, rakshasas. And those in the mode of ignorance worship ghosts and spirits. So that's why you'll see some of these people in the mode of ignorance, they will be hanging around in crematoriums or graveyards. And in the night, they will silently worship these ghosts like that. People in the mode of passion, they worship the demons. Like, for example, during Second World War, there was one businessman in Calcutta who was worshiping Hitler. As you know, Hitler killed so many people. He's not a proper person. He's like a rakshasa. He's a demon. But men in the mode of passion, because some businessmen were benefiting because of Hitler. When Hitler was started the war, all the price of products went up. So all the people who had a lot of rice and wheat in godowns, they became very rich. So they started worshipping Hitler. Oh, because of Hitler, I became rich. Right? That's mode of passion. And men in of god of goodness worship the devatas. So like people who want to be calm, contented, follow the rules and regulations, they will pray to the devatas, demigods. And men who are even higher than this, and that is coming in the next few verses, worships only the Supreme Lord Krishna, Vishnu or Krishna. So Vishnu, when he's at home, he is like Krishna. And Krishna, when he's in office, he is like Vishnu. So basically, same person, two different roles. In the office, you have to be very formal, you know, wear nice clothes and speak carefully. Whereas in home, you can just be in shorts and you can speak casually. Nobody's going to trouble you, right? So that's what it is. So when Vishnu is at home, he is like Krishna. Very casual. And when Krishna is in office, he is like Vishnu. Very formal. That's all. They are the same personality, but different approaches to people around them. Okay. So Nagaprabhu, please read.
In this verse, the Supreme Personality of Godhead describes different kinds of worshippers according to their external activities. According to scriptural injunctions, only the Supreme Personality of Godhead is worshipable. But those who are not very conversant with or faithful to the scriptural injunctions worship different objects according to their specific situations in the mode of material nature. Those who are situated in goodness generally worship the demigods. The demigods include Brahma, Shiva, and others such as Indra, Chandra, and the sun god. There are various demigods. Those in goodness worships a particular demigod for a particular purpose. Similarly, those who are in the mode of passion worships the demons. We recall that during the Second World War, a man in Calcutta who worshipped Hitler because thanks to the war, he had amassed a large amount of wealth by dealing in the black market. Similarly, those in the mode of passion and ignorance generally select a powerful man to be God. They think that anyone can be worshipped as God and that the same result will be obtained. Now, it is clearly described here that those who are in the mode of passion worship and create such gods, and those who are in the mode of ignorance in darkness worship dead spirits. Sometimes people worship at the tomb of some dead man. Sexual service is also considered to be in the mode of darkness. Similarly, in remote villages in India, there are worshippers of ghosts. We have seen that in India, the lower class people sometimes go to the forest, and if they have knowledge that a ghost lives in a tree, they worship the tree and offer sacrifices. These different kind of worships are not actually God worship. God worship is for persons who are transcendentally situated in pure goodness. In the Srimad Bhagavatam 4.3.23, it is said, Sattvam Vishuddham Vasudev Sabditam. When a man is situated in pure goodness, he worships Vasudeva. The purport is that those who are completely purified of the material modes of nature and who are transcendentally situated can worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The impersonalists are supposed to be situated in the mode of goodness, and they worship 5 kind of demigods. They worship the impersonal Vishnu form in the material world, which is known as philosophized Vishnu. Vishnu is the expression of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But the impersonalist, because they do not ultimately believe in the Supreme Personality of Godhead, imagine that the Vishnu form is just another aspect of the impersonal Brahman. Similarly, they imagine that the Lord Brahma is the impersonal form in the material mode of passion. Thus, they sometimes describe 5 kind of gods that they worshipable, but because they think that the actual truth is impersonal Brahman, they dispose of all worshipable objects at the ultimate end. In conclusion, the different qualities of the material modes of nature can be purified through association with persons who are of transcendental nature.
Yeah, this is a lot of good information here. So when a man is situated in pure goodness, he worships Vasudeva. Sattvam Vishuddham Vasudeva Sabditham. The purport is that those who are completely purified of the material modes of nature and who are transcendentally situated can worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Means, unless we are out of ignorance, passion and goodness, these three different states or modes, we cannot reach Krishna. We have to be purified. Otherwise, we'll be locked in one of those three cells. Right? In each of the three cells, there is a certain type of worship that is natural and we'll just stick to that. So we have to rise above these three different forms of worship, basically. And then Prabhupada talks about impersonalist. Person. Who is a person? You are a person, I'm a person. Personal God means God is a person. But impersonalist, they say that God doesn't have any shape or form. So, what happens? They just worship 5 different kind of gods, but ultimately they say that all these things have to be given up before liberation, like that. So that is what is being said here. And then finally, Prabhupada says, in conclusion, the different qualities of material modes of nature can be purified through association. Means if the more you talk to the senior devotees who have already realized Krishna, then you will also get that faith. Faith comes from faith. So any questions on this one? This is a very important topic. Okay, so let's move on.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead. What's your question?
No problem. Yeah, no.
Okay, so now 17 verses 5 and 6. Ashastra vihitam ghoram.
Ashastra vihitam ghoram.
दम्बाहंकार संयुक्ता
दम्बाहंकार
संयुक्ता
काम राग बलान्विता
काम राग बलान्विता
कर्षयन्ता शरीरास्तम
कर्षयन्ता शरीरास्तम
भूतग्राममचेतसः
भूतग्राम अचेतसः
माम चैवान्त शरीरस्तम
माम चैवान्त शरीरास्तम
थान विद्धि आसुर निश्चयान्
थान विद्धि
Those who undergo severe austerity penances are not recommended in the scriptures. Performing them out of pride and egoism, who are impelled by lust and attachment, who are foolish and who torture the material elements of the body, as well as the super soul dwelling within, are to be known as demons. So scriptures will say, you fast on certain days. But people will say, yeah, let me see. See, look, I can fast for 10 days nonstop. Like some people who want to control weight, they'll fast for a long time, which is not recommended by the scriptures. Right? Why do they do like that? Because they're impelled by lust and attachment. Lust means desire to achieve something. Attachment means you cannot get away from that object of attachment. So in this way, what happens? They torture their own body. They'll do things. Once in a while, we also do that. But demons make it a pretty standard topic. They want to torture their own body. Very classic example is Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha, when they were doing tapas. They are just incarnations of Jaya and Vijaya. Right? But however, they perform severe austerities, like not eating for X number of days, things like that. All for just some mundane power. If the same thing is done for Krishna, then it is a great achievement because there's high probability that Krishna will take you and you'll get liberated. But such people do it out of pride. Right? Two things Krishna mentions, pride and egoism. So it's one thing to turn to Lord and do austerities for the Lord, but then you have to put up with the problems that will come along the way. But it's a different thing to just do it for show. Pride and egoism. Right? So yeah, we have to be very careful because we could also be behaving like demons from time to time, according to Krishna's judgment. Right? We may allow pride and egoism come in, and we may do things according to our own will. We may, you know, do exactly what is expected of us from a dharmic perspective. We may save that. And when we are expected to act, we may act in a different way. Right? So from time to time, we also act like demons. But hopefully, predominantly, we have divine qualities. That's the hope. And if not, we can acquire them. How can we acquire? By chanting mantras, by doing certain things. And then those qualities will gradually come in. Right? Because when we are born, we don't necessarily have those qualities. We acquire them from our surroundings, except for some people who are like, you know, hell-bent on doing certain things, as they say, which means even from the point of birth, they are always in that mood. Okay, so Shiva, read one more time.
Okay. There are persons who manufacture modes of austerity and penance which are not mentioned in the spiritual injunctions. For instance, fasting for some ulterior purpose, such as to promote a purely political end, is not mentioned in the scriptural directions. The scriptures recommend fasting for spiritual advancement, not for political end or social purpose. Persons who take to such austerities are, according to Bhagavad Gita, certainly demonic. Their acts are against the scriptural injunctions and are not beneficial for the people in general. Actually, they act out of pride, false ego, lust, and attachment for material enjoyment. By such activities, not only is the combination of material elements of which the body is constructed disturbed, but also the personality of Godhead living within the body. Such unauthorized fasting or austerities for some political end are very disturbing to others. They are not mentioned in the Vedic literature. A demonic person may think that he can force his enemy or other parties to comply with his desire by this. But sometimes one dies by fasting. These acts are not approved by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And he says that those who engage in them are demons. Such demonstrations are insults to the Supreme Personality of Godhead because they are enacted in disobedience to the Vedic scriptural injections. The word achitesa is significant in this connection. Persons of normal mental condition must obey the scriptural injections. Those who are not in such a position neglect and disobey the scriptures and manufacture their own way of austerities and penances. One should always remember the ultimate end of the demonic people as described in the previous chapter. The Lord forces them to take birth in the wombs of demonic persons. Consequently, they will live by demonic principles, life after life, without knowing their relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. If, however, such persons are fortunate enough to be guided by a spiritual master who can direct them to the path of Vedic wisdom, they can get out of this entanglement and ultimately achieve the supreme goal.
Yeah, so if somebody is intending to act in a demoniac fashion, Krishna will give them wombs of demoniac mothers, life after life. So you never have chance of coming back to Krishna like that, right? However, if those people are fortunate enough to be guided by a spiritual master who can direct them to the path of Vedic wisdom, then such people can get out of that entanglement or that loop. Otherwise, you're pretty much stuck in that loop. You're just going life after life, right? So we are very fortunate because Prabhupada is giving us this information to better our lifestyle and finally get to the desired result, which is liberation and love of God. So we have to be careful, right? Because we will see and we will be influenced by such forces. So there will be people around us who might drag us down in that direction. So we have to be super careful. Okay, let's chant now. I am a little tired today, so we will do a short class.
Sure, sir.